When Atlantic Yards was first approved in 2006, the project promised to provide 2,250 units of affordable housing by 2016. In exchange, Atlantic Yards received hundreds of millions of dollars in public subsidies, zoning overrides, and access to the power of eminent domain.
When the project was introduced, it was introduced with the promise of affordable housing. Everybody knows that in New York City there's a housing crisis, and more specifically there's an affordable housing crisis.
I was really excited because they were saying that they were going to have affordable apartments, that was going to be part of the big stadium.
But before the final agreements were signed in 2009, the New York State Empire State Development Corporation allowed Forest City Ratner companies to delay Atlantic Yards completion, including its affordable housing, until 2035. Since then, the median rent in Brooklyn has continued to skyrocket.
Until now, the Atlantic Yards project has really been the worst of both worlds. We've had a multi-billion dollar project that has really fueled speculation, gentrification, and displacement, while at the same time, the affordable housing that was supposed to help mitigate those gentrification displacement pressures has been delayed.
Gentrification is now causing rapid displacement of African-American residents in Brooklyn Community Districts 2, 3, 6, and 8, areas which surround the Atlantic Yards project and whose residents are to receive preference for its affordable apartments. Each year affordable housing units are delayed, fewer African Americans will be eligible to receive preference in the affordable housing lotteries through which the apartments will be awarded, while the number of white residents eligible for preference, many of whom have yet to arrive, will increase.
The result of the delay in the construction of affordable housing is having a disparate impact on tens of thousands of African American families in Northwest Brooklyn.
I have four generations of family that lived in community Board 8, four generations, and I've seen over the years that a lot of families were getting pushed out.
On its face, there's nothing discriminatory about the delay. But there's a discriminatory impact because of the rate of gentrification in Brooklyn. The longer that build timeline gets pushed out, the more of an impact it's going to have on the African-American community, because more and more of African-Americans in Brooklyn are going to be priced out of their homes. And so less and less of them are going to benefit when the housing finally gets built.
Government agencies are not allowed to make decisions respecting housing that would discriminate, whether those decisions are intentional or whether it's a de facto effect of their decisions has the effect of discrimination against protected classes.
The Fair Housing Act is an anti-discrimination act that prohibits denying housing to someone on the basis of race, religion, national origin, etc.
The delay of affordable housing under the 2009 agreements between the Empire State Development Corporation and Forest City Ratner companies would have violated U.S. civil rights laws. A coalition of community advocates and residents prepared to file suit seeking changes to accelerate the delivery of affordable housing.
We were forced into a corner where the only strategy left to us was to sue.
After we had completed our legal research, we met separately with Forest City Ratner and with the Empire State Development Corporation. We discussed our concerns about the delay in affordable housing at Atlantic Yards. And after a few weeks of negotiations, they concluded that it was preferable to agree to accelerate affordable housing than to risk the potential of a federal civil rights lawsuit.
On June 27, 2014, the parties announced a settlement that included a commitment to complete Atlantic Yards affordable housing significantly earlier than previously agreed, as well as changes to project oversight that include local representation.
The billion-dollar Barclays Center opened in Brooklyn nearly 2 years ago to much acclaim, but since then, not one of the affordable housing units promised as part of the development deal has been built. Well, neighborhood groups were threatening to sue. Now, though, there is an accelerated plan that puts affordable housing on the front burner, promising more than 2,000 apartments 10 years ahead of the current schedule.
It's not, you know, a magic bullet. It's not going to solve the housing crisis in itself, but it does give us access to affordable housing sooner than what the developer was, you know, trying to lay out initially. And it also gives us a seat at the table.
The 2009 agreements call for Forest City to have started construction of 300 affordable apartments by 2020 as part of the project's first phase. Under the terms of the settlement, The Atlantic Yards developers must begin at least 590 affordable apartments by June of 2015. The settlement further requires the developers to complete all of the promised 2,250 affordable units by 2025, 10 years earlier than previously agreed. Failure to meet the targets for starting and completing the remaining affordable housing at Atlantic Yards will result in significant financial penalties to the developers.
What's also significant is that these are now part of the agreement between the state and Forest City Ratner. It's not a separate agreement, side agreement between the sponsors of Brooklyn Speaks and Forest City Ratner companies. It's an agreement between the state that has real penalties and real teeth.
As part of the settlement, the state of New York and the city of New York agreed that any liquidated damages collected will be deposited in the New York City Affordable Housing Trust Fund to be used for the preservation or construction of housing for low-income populations with a preference to projects in the communities surrounding Atlantic Yards in Brooklyn.
In addition to that, Forest City Ratner agreed to make a one-time payment of $250,000 to create the Atlantic Yards Tenant Protection Fund, which will go to eviction prevention and anti-displacement services in the communities surrounding the project.
Finally, the state of New York agreed to create the Atlantic Yards Community Development Corporation, a subsidiary of the Empire State Development Corporation, charged with monitoring the project's compliance with its public commitments.
What's significant about the Atlantic Yards Community Development Corporation is that for the first time since the project was announced in 2003, the local community and its elected officials will have representation in project oversight.
AYCDC will be guided by a board of 14 members, five of whom will be appointed by local elected officials. The state is required to establish AYCDC by the end of 2014. In addition to ensuring timely delivery of affordable housing based upon the terms of the settlement, AYCDC will monitor the project's compliance with environmental commitments intended to reduce the impact of construction on its neighbors and coordinate communications between developers, city agencies, elected officials, and community members. AYCDC will also be responsible for reviewing any future changes to the Atlantic Yards plan. The Atlantic Yards project is expected to make use of city subsidies to finance its affordable housing. Affordability targets for apartments financed with city subsidies are based upon federal area median income, which includes New York City and Westchester County.
The average median income for Brooklyn is only about 60% of federal AMI. Nearly a third of the next 590 affordable apartments to be built at Atlantic Yards will be offered to residents earning 60% of AMI or less. That obviously leaves an opportunity for deeper affordability through changes in city subsidy policy for the next 1,480 units to come.
Based on the fact that HUD AMI is increasing three times faster than Brooklyn's AMI, every year those affordable housing units are delayed, it's less affordable to Brooklyn families.
The settlement did not address the level of affordability of the Atlantic Yards subsidized apartments. The planned lawsuit claimed the disparate impact of the delay of the provisions of the affordable apartments under federal fair housing law. It did not have a basis on which to challenge city subsidy policy.
There really is an ongoing need for advocacy to make the affordable units at Atlantic Yards affordable to Brooklyn's families.
Rezonings and large-scale redevelopment projects, even those with affordable housing components, tend to accelerate gentrification and displacement. Accountability of such projects must be ensured so that promised affordable housing is delivered on a timely basis to meet the needs of populations threatened with displacement.
The Atlantic Yards settlement represents the culmination of 7 years of advocacy by community groups and local elected officials to achieve accountability at a major development project.
I think it's very important for people to realize the extent that the groups and the individual plaintiffs were willing to go to demand that they were heard by the developer and by our elected officials.
This is really critical because more and more affordable housing is expected to be provided through public-private partnerships. And we have to show that the community can fight for accountability to hold developers to the promises they make.
I feel really good about being a part of this because what it says to me is that anybody can get together and make sure that the story is told and that the people are heard.
Developers and government have an obligation to help mitigate the effects of gentrification and displacement in the communities in which projects are allowed to develop. Although continued vigilance will still be required, The Atlantic Yard settlement shows that coalitions of civic organizations, affordable housing advocates, and elected officials who are strategic and stay the course can be successful in impacting public policy and ensuring accountability.